Good evening, everybody. Today we are going to start with interrupt and exception handling in ARM7. Okay, so what are interrupts and what are exceptions? This is a brief overview, but we'll first start with what are interrupts and what are exceptions. What is the difference? What is the similarity? Now, interrupts and exceptions both are the events which occur and they alter the normal execution flow of the program. So they just like, they act like as if we are calling a subroutine, which is different from the program which is currently being executed. Okay. So our current, let's say some program is going on. That program has to be stopped temporarily and something immediate which needs more attention, it is being attended to by the processor. So this is what we mean by interrupts or exceptions. Now, what are interrupts? They are basically used to handle the external events. That is, I'm reading a document or I'm doing some work in my Word. And suppose I connect my USB. So my USB window will open. So that connection to a USB port, that interfacing to the peripherals, which are external, those are normally asynchronous in nature and they are from the hardware. So those are referred to as interrupts, whereas exceptions are the processors and processors handling of some unexpected events during the program execution in itself. That is, our program is being executed, it is being running, and let's say I'm running a program in C and there is a loop which is running for division and suddenly there is division by zero. So that invokes an exception. So that is what exception is. So it is something which is coming unexpectedly from the application or the system itself and is being handled by the system itself. Okay, so in context of ARM7, FIQ, IRQ and the reset, they are the interrupts because they are external. They can be generated from the hardware and they are asynchronous. Whereas exceptions are abort, that can be a data abort, that can be a prefetch abort, undefined operation, and the software interrupt. So they are all handled by operating system and they are exceptions. Okay. And interrupts, they are generally non-maskable by controlling the CPSR bits. CPSR bits actually we can set, so but we cannot, if an interrupt is occurring, I cannot mask that by changing the bit using the software. That is another, because it is external. Another difference between that. When I talk about exception handling and interrupt handling, I can broadly say that interrupts, they are sub-part of exceptions which have to be handled. They are generated from the external event and may be maskable, non-maskable, or they may be external. Okay? So that masking and non-masking, that is not too much valid in the context of ARM, but in case of microprocessor, it is very important. So now we come to exceptions. In ARM7, we have 7 different exceptions which have been defined, and all of them, they are vectored interrupts. That is, all of them, they are having a fixed address in the memory at which their subroutine address is given. Once that exception occurs. So all of them, they are having a vectored address. So that address where all the exceptions are having their address is also called the vector table. So first we talk about reset. Reset is nothing but system reset. Normally we refer to this, since it is asynchronous, if we are talking about the interrupt, that is referring to the hard reset which is there. So it leads to initialization of the processor all again. Okay. And the vector address of this is the first address which is there in the memory of ARM7, that is 000. Okay. Next is undefined. Undefined, it is when actually processor encounters an instruction which it is not recognizing. In that case, it first sends that instruction to its coprocessor. If none of the coprocessor also accepts that instruction, then it is termed as undefined. Okay, So then the undefined exception, it is invoked by the system, and the vector address for that is 00004. Okay. Software interrupt, it is normally used to jump to certain OS routines, operating system routines, system routines. So it actually moves to the supervisor mode, and it is said to be a programmed instructions, because software interrupt actually it is an instruction which we normally can write in our program. It is followed by ampersand and a number. So based on that number, some address of a subroutine is called from the operating system, which changes the mode of the processor from system or the user mode to the supervisor mode, and the particular subroutine of operating system is being run. Next we come to prefetch abort. Prefetch abort is actually about when there is an invalid memory access for an instruction. It is not that instruction is not valid. If an instruction is not valid or not recognized, that would be undefined. Invalid memory access means, suppose we all know that there is a virtual memory and there is a physical memory when we are talking about this any system. Okay, so there is a mapping between the virtual and the physical address. Suppose we are referring to an instruction which was previously there to map to a physical address, but now it has been moved from that physical address and is stored in a secondary address, secondary memory. So in that case, there will be an prefetch abort error, because that memory address is not physically existing, though the virtual address may be there. Similarly, data abort is also abort, memory abort operation, but due to non-accessibility of the data. And again, the vector address for this is given as to be 000010. So all these vector addresses, they are different by 4 because 32 bits, we know that ARM7 is going to work on 32 bits. So each memory location size is 8 bits. So 8 into 4, it is 32. So that is why the difference of 4 is occurring between all the memory addresses. Next we come to is IRQ. It is an external generated interrupt. Okay. And FIQ is also external generated interrupt, known to be as fast interrupt, which has a highest or the higher priority than IRQ. So with this knowledge, we move to the next slide. Here we know that ARM7 is having 7 modes. Okay, varying from system mode, user mode, undefined mode, abort mode, supervisor mode, IRQ, FIQ, and abort mode. So basically, when exception occur, each of this exception is going to change the mode of the processor from the system or the user mode to any particular specialized mode. Okay, that is the way the exception has to be handled. So it is part of exception handling. So for that, we need to understand what is the mapping between the modes which are occurring and the exceptions which are there. So it can be clearly seen that reset, it is mapped to the supervisor mode. Similarly, the software interrupt is also mapped to the supervisor mode. Data abort and prefetch abort, they are mapped to the abort mode, processor mode. FIQ is mapped to FIQ, one-to-one mapping. IRQ is mapped to IRQ mode, again one-to-one mapping. Whereas, so all these 5 modes are there, and user and system modes, they are not there in exception handling. They are only used for the normal execution of the program. Okay, so they are not included in exception handling. Now, what actually happens when exception occurs? So whenever an exception occurs, okay, suppose I have done a division by 0, then what happens? So when a division by 0, it is happening, it is not, it is going to give me an abort operation. It is not undefined, it is not a software interrupt, it is an abort operation. So in that case, data abort. So in that case, what happens is, whenever an exception is occurring, the current contents of the program counter, they are moved to the linked register, that is R14. Of that particular exception mode. This we should get from the programmer's model of ARM7. We know that there is a concept of banked registers, where each processor mode is having its own set of registers, its own CPSR, SPSR, where we can bank or store the information. Okay. So that particular linked list R14 of that particular mode is used, not of the user mode or not what is visible to me as a user. So the program counter contents, they are loaded into the R14 or the linked register of that particular exception. And in turn, your program counter is loaded with the vector address of that particular exception. For example, if the data abort is occurring, so data abort is occurring, division by zero is there. So my program contents, program counter contents, they will go to the R14 of which mode? Abort mode. Okay. And my program counter will now be loaded. Now it is changing the mode. And CPSR is loading its content into the, saving its contents to the SPSR of the exception mode, that is the abort mode. So when the abort has, data abort has occurred, whatever was there in the program counter, that is stored in the linked register of abort exception, and CPSR contents from the user mode, they have moved to the SPSR of abort mode. Okay. After this, once my mode is changed, my program counter is now loaded with, what is the work of program counter? To get the address of the next instruction to be fetched. So now it is going to get the address first of the vector address of the exception. For data abort, that vector address is 0000004. Okay, so we'll go to that particular address. And CPSR, what it is loading? CPSR, actually it is loaded with the changed value of CPSR, in which the five bits for the mode which are used in the CPSR, they are changed according to that particular mode and they are loaded into the CPSR. So once that mode change takes place, now why we are actually saving the previous program counter contents in CPSR, so that after the servicing of the exception, we have to go back to our program from where the exception occurs. So we are actually saving it in the bank register of that particular mode. Okay. So except for reset, which is also an exception in ARM, on the ARM, whenever an exception occurs, they will complete its current execution, including FIQ and IRQ. Then it will go to servicing of that particular exception. Okay. So all the vector addresses, though they are only one bit, basically they are only one 32-bit address. Okay. So they will further contain the address of another memory location where the subroutine for servicing this particular exception on the steps which are required to handle the situation which has occurred due to this exception has been written, it will go to that particular address. So vector address pe kya hota hai, ek aur address rahega jo point out karega the subroutine where it is, the address where the subroutine is stored to handle this particular exception which has occurred. So all of them, they normally jump to another address from their vector address, except for FIQ. We don't require it in case of FIQ, because if we pay attention to my, just a minute, we'll go to the others. So if I pay attention, the highest, my memory, it is starting from 00. So that first 00 address, it is going to reset. Next is 4 going to undefined, 008 going to software, 00C to prefetch, and so on. So the highest address which is there, that is going to FIQ. So we are assuming that we are having the memory available over 1/C. So FIQ can start storing its routine from this particular location only, instead of jumping to another address. Others, they don't have any space available. But it has the space available because this is the last or the highest address in the vector table. Okay. So FIQ can know that. Now this is basically the memory map, what is used. So a total of 4 GB memory, linear memory, is available to ARM7, in which mapping of RAM, ROM, as well as input-output devices are there. So your exceptions, they start from 00 and they move up towards 1C till FIQ. Above that, we have the interrupt handlers. So what are these interrupt handlers? This is what we know. Branch to reset means it will contain the address of the subroutine where reset handling instructions are written. Undefined means it is going to jump to another address where a set of instructions for handling the undefined exception is written. But what are these interrupt handlers? Interrupt handlers are further the actual addresses to which these addresses are pointing out. For example, undefined vector, it is at the address undefined, I think it is at 0010. So if it is at one, let's say undefined, it is at 0010. No, reset. Let's say we talk about reset. Reset is at 0000. So once the reset occurs, first my program counter will move to 0000. That is its vector table address. At 000, we'll further get another address of memory location where actually my code for handling this reset is written. Here it will be instructions to reinitialize or initialize the processor and start from the beginning. Okay, so this is how it works. So interrupt handlers, they are nothing but they are actually the detailed subroutines written for handling the interrupts. I hope it is clear. Next we come to understanding how these exceptions they work. So we'll take it one by one. So if my reset, first of all, we need to familiarize ourselves with the priority, because multiple exceptions can occur at the same time. So in that case, priority of the exception will decide which exception has to be serviced earlier and which has to be serviced later. Okay, so reset has the highest priority, whereas the software interrupt has the lowest priority. Lowest because it is a programmed exception. Okay, so next to reset, it is data abort. Then we have FIQ, next IRQ, then prefetch abort, undefined, and the software. Now, once the reset occurs, what happens? When the reset is occur, first thing is, as usual, moving to the vector address you already know. Okay, so program counter contents, in that case, they are not needed because it is going to go to the first instruction or the initialization of the processor. So it is going to the address where your initialization code for the processor is written. So there is no need of coming back to your program. But in addition to that, in your CPSR, your F bit is set one. When you set your F bit, you are actually disabling your fast interrupt so that it cannot interfere with your reset. Okay. Next we come to is data abort. When data abort occurs, whatever is the aborted instruction plus 8 addresses to them, that is stored in your LR. Okay. And your program counter is loaded with the vector address of the data abort. Okay. And when we have to come back, for coming back, what is required is, we have from whatever are the contents of the LR of this abort mode, we have to subtract 8 from that, and we will come back at the same instruction at which the data abort exception occurred. To understand this, we'll move to this. Okay, why 8 is required. Okay, so let's say this is the address where the address of the instruction, and this is the instructions which have been pipelined. So here I am showing all the stages of the pipeline, and these are my cycles, timing cycles, T1, T2, T3, T4. So first my LNR, that is the time T1 it is getting fetched. Okay. And addresses this 00200. Okay. And this time the program counter is fetching the or pointing to the next address to be fetched. The next instruction is at the address 004. So the contents of PC at this stage are referring to 20004 memory address. Okay. Once we come to our time cycle D2, our instruction, first instruction LDR, that moves into decode stage, while the next instruction, which was pointed by program counter, that is being fetched. Okay. During time T3, our first instruction, it is moving into execution, while second instruction, it is going into decode, but the third instruction is getting fetched. That is getting fetched from which address? 2008. And the program counter, it is incremented to one instruction ahead. That is at address of multiply at 2000C. Okay. So we see that PC is always ahead of 4. Now suppose my data abort occurs at this add instruction. Okay. Now data abort means my data is not accessible. So it will successfully go through fetch where the instruction is fetched. It will successfully go through decode stage where the instruction is decoded. But when it moves into the execution stage, in the execution, my data path is enabled where I can fetch the data. And this abort will occur. So during T4, what is happening? Now at this stage, what is my program counter? Program counter is already pointing to 2000C. Okay. So what I do is, whatever is my instruction at which it occurred. So what is the instruction at which it occurred? That is 20004. I will plus 8 in that. I will do plus 8 because plus 8 is referring to fetch of this instruction during time T4. So basically my add was aborted in T4, and in that time my fetch was happening of the instruction which is stored at the address 200C. That is, it is 8 addresses ahead of my instruction at which the abort occurred. So for that reason, I plus 8 to the instruction address at which the data abort occurred. And when I have to come back, what I have to do? Now my LR is containing this 000200C. I will minus 8 from this. Okay, so minusing 8, if I subtract 8 from 200C, it will come back to 2004. That is at the same instruction at which my data abort had occurred. So I hope you understand why plus 8 is required in case of data abort, both plus 8 when we are moving into that exception mode, and minus 8 when we are coming back from that exception mode. Now coming to the other exceptions, FIQ. In FIQ, it is like PC, it is incremented by 4 because that is next abort. Nahi sirf we are requiring plus 8. Other cases we require only plus 4. Okay, because a PC is always looking ahead by one instruction. My data actually abort is happening in the execute stage. So that made it to jump to 8. Otherwise, it is 4 only what we require. You can do it in a similar way. Similar analogy, like we took the example, you can try and do it and understand why it is plus 4. So whenever FIQ is occurring at any particular instruction, it is incremented by plus 4 because that particular instruction at which this FIQ interrupt occurs, that would be executed. Okay. And then my interrupt handling would take place and it would come back to the next instruction after the instruction at which my FIQ had occurred. Similar, it is for IRQ. So while we are moving into that particular mode, it is plus 4. When we are coming back, we are doing minus 4. Prefetch abort, it is again the instruction abort that is going to take place in the first phase only, that is in the fetch phase only. So that also requires only plus 4 and similarly minus 4. Undefined instruction, we are moving to the next instruction, that is we are incrementing it by plus 4 when we are moving into the particular mode, that is undefined mode, but we are not doing the minus 4. Why? Because that instruction is undefined. We don't have to come back and try to re-execute by changing it or doing some modification. That instruction is not part of ARM instruction, so that has to be removed or not to be executed. So we are not doing the minus 4. And similarly for software interrupt, we are incrementing it by plus 4 because software, it is a programmed interrupt. I wanted that to happen. I wanted a particular subroutine to be called. That has been called. Now I don't want to go and re-execute that. It was not an error of that instruction. Rather, I want to service the next instruction, which was after software. So we need not put minus 4 here. Okay, I hope it is clear to all of you. And yes, in case of prefetch undefined in software, we have to put our I bit is equal to 1 in our CPSR so that no interrupt occurs during this particular exception handling. Okay. So this I have already explained. Next important thing, which is there is interrupt latency. Now what do we understand by interrupt latency actually? Interrupt latency actually is the time which lapses between when an interrupt request occurs and the time to when the servicing of that particular interrupt happens. That is, its interrupt service routine has been executed or implemented. Okay. So this depends upon both how by hardware and software they have been configured to handle a particular interrupt. So it will all matter on whether your interrupts, they are re-entrant, whether it is a preemptive, non-preemptive. We're not going into details, but that is how it is depending both on the hardware and the software. We can minimize it. Obviously, we want the interrupt latency to be minimum. We have to design a system normally that if in case of multiple interrupts they are occurring, how the system handles. So there are two main ways how we handle it. Either the nested interrupt handling scheme is used or a prioritization scheme is used. Prioritization means we will what at the current time T1, we will see what are the three exceptions which have occurred and which is having the highest priority, that particular exception would be serviced. Whereas in the nesting, if during execution or handling of one interrupt another occurs, that has to be handled. We cannot deny it, okay, I am going to complete this. We can configure our software to handle and see what is its priority and how important it is to the system. So there are multiple schemes. I think almost 9 schemes are there for interrupt handling in ARM7. Okay. And normally the worst case latency could be understood for, let's say, if there is FIQ, except interrupt which is there. Now we know that in ARM, whenever an interrupt occurs, whatever is the current instruction which is executing, that will complete. So suppose we are having a block transfer happening through LDM or STM, okay? And it is 10 blocks which are going to be copied from memory to register or register to memory anyways, and FIQ occurs. Now, though FIQ has the highest priority, but still, it will not happen till your whole instruction of LDM, whole copying of that LDM instruction takes place and then my FIQ. So that would give me the worst case latency. And further, it could become worse if my FIQ further gets into data about inlet, say in the fifth memory location, which it is copying. So that would further lead to a complication and increase of the latency. Otherwise, FIQ is said to have the minimum latency time. Okay, so that was all about interrupts and exceptions in ARM7. This was a brief introduction. there are schemes for handling those. Those could be referred to from Andrew's Law's book. Thank you so much.